All right, so today we're continuing with the sermon series, Core Values of the Church, the important values as a church and as a Christian, as God-fearing people must live by, okay? And this today is the last one. It's the seven core values. We've been going this for 7 weeks, and it spells acrostic power. You'll realize there's only five letters in power, but there are seven core values. That's because there are three core values to the letter P, okay? So to review the things that we've been talking about, skip that. Go to the next one, John. All right. Okay, let's read this section. So this is the message that John got. I was in the spirit of the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet saying, write in a book what you see and send it to the seven churches. Two, and these churches over here. Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea, okay? And it kind of goes in that order in a circle, which is kind of very organized. You wouldn't expect that, but it does. It goes kind of up and down, and now we're at Laodicea. We're going to talk about Laodicea, but before we do that, let's review, okay? Oops. I keep pressing this and you keep pressing that. Can you put it back, John? All right. So basically, the seven letters to the seven churches is a warning to the church. There's a comprehensive warning to all the churches, and it speaks to us too. For the churches here and for people in the church, Christian, it's warning. There's a seven warnings. From Ephesus, we learned, we were warned of losing our first love, okay? That whatever we do in life, it should be out of love, out of compassion, love for God and love for others, okay? That's the first point, okay? And in all the activities that we do, the business, we could lose the love, okay? And so the core value for that was relationships, okay? We need to value our relationships with God and with one another, okay? Smyrna. We're warned of the fear of suffering, you know, avoiding suffering, okay? We want to be comfortable as possible. When hard times come, you know, we don't know what to do, right? But Jesus said, I'm with you. The suffering and the trials are there for a reason. So persevere, the core value number two. Persevere in the midst of trials, okay? Church of Pergamum, we learned about the compromising the truth, okay? And the core value three is, it's hard to read, Word of God first. Okay, we learned the value of holding on to the Word of God, the Bible, okay? Next. Okay, Thyatira. Okay, John's going to tell you. Okay, next. Moral compromise, okay? Fear of moral compromise. And so we learned the value of purity, right? Next. And Sardis. Keep going. Spiritual deadness, right? The church was dead. And so the core value there was evangelion, the gospel of Christ, which gives life. And we need to live for the gospel, right? Don't forget to live for the gospel, that the gospel is supposed to propel us to live and change us in a certain way. Philadelphia, the fear, the failure to hold on, right? And Pastor Zeta came, he spoke about obedience, how obedience is worship, right? Laodicea, that's what we're going to talk about. And it's the fear, the complacency and lukewarmness in our life. There's no direction, there's no passion, there's no commitment to the holy things of God. And so we need to hold on to the passion for Christ, okay? Oh, we have passions. We have a lot of passions. But sometimes passion's in the wrong places. And we don't get the kind of blessings that God wants to give to us, right? So I'm going to talk to you guys about passion today. Okay, so perseverance, purity. This is it's all right. Yeah. By the way, that's El Capitan, Yosemite. If you haven't been there, awesome, right? There's an 85-year-old man who cleared that, so we should be able to do it. So key. Perseverance, purity, and passion. Okay, those are the three. O, obedience. W, word of God. E, evangelion, which means the gospel, like I said. R, relationship. Power. These core values, I believe, will give us power. I'm really into acrostics. Yeah, it's kind of cool, right? It's kind of hard making it fit. That's why I had to use evangelion. Couldn't think of a word that fits there, but who knows what that is? It's not from Lord of the Rings, okay? It's a diamond in the rough. A diamond in the rough is an expression to describe someone that has hidden exceptional characteristics and future potential, but currently lacks the final touches that would make them truly stand out from the crowd. And the phrase is metaphorical because it relates to the fact that natural occurring diamonds like this you see are quite ordinary at first glance, and that their true beauty as jewels is only realized through the cutting and polishing process. Do you know what the most treasured thing that you have is? Any human being has? It's your potential. No one can take away your potential to be who God created you to be. Your purpose for why you are here, why you were created, why you're breathing, and the potential for you to become. Some of us are diamonds in the rough. But not all diamonds are found. Not all diamonds are cut to its beauty. Not all people live up to their potential or their purpose. Are you living up to the purpose and the potential God created you to be? Are you in the zone, so to speak, you know? Like when Stephen Curry says he's in the zone, he's just throwing, everything he goes up is going, three goes in, half court, that's in. He comes out of half court, out of the field, throws it up, goes in. Are you in the zone? Are you living for your purpose? The sad thing is not everyone is, and you may, if it's not you, you know some friends or family members who are not living up to their potential. You know, when I was growing up, I admired my dad. I lived in the Buena Vista Avenue. When I was growing up, like, that was the street to be, because all the kids, you know, that's where all the activities, you know, that's where the kids got together, because, you know, we would get together, play tag at night, you know, bike tag, we'd go swimming, and you know, we'll do other things. Anyway, it was a place to be. It was a ghetto, actually, though. It was a ghetto, you know? You know what a ghetto is, right? Government-subsidized housing, very cheap to live. Well, I didn't know that, but it was the place to be. It was so fun. All my friends lived there, you know, like 400 units, right? Like, just everyone's there. Like, we used to go doorbell ditching. You know what that is? You ever do that? Yeah, you do that in Calgary? You can't really do that here, right? But like, yeah, in the projects, in the ghettos, you have all these doors, right? And you'll just ding, 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 ring all the doors and just run. And you just hear these people come out. Hey, who is it? Hey, who is it? Who did that? We'll just laugh. But that's the kind of place we live, you know? But we live in the ghetto, but... And so all my friends, you know, they're all blue collar. My friends' family, like my friends' dads, they're all like truck drivers, drug dealers, drug takers, you know, thieves, or whatever. We had our house broken into like three times. So So whenever you got something new, you couldn't tell anyone. As soon as you, and that was my mistake, I was so naive, so innocent. Hey guys, I got a new PlayStation. It was gone the next week. They cut a hole through the door. Like our storage, there was a storage that was connected to our house and you could access it from the hallway. So what they did was they opened the storage and cut a hole through the wall into our apartment and took our week-old PlayStation. That was like the first PlayStation that ever came out. I was like, you know, that's the kind of place we live in, yeah. Our friends, parents were blue collar, but my dad was white collar, you know? White collar, I'm talking about white. White suit. So when I saw him walking, you know, toward us while, you know, we were playing in his suit and tie, carrying his suitcase, you know? And you hear his steps, because he's wearing boots, right? Like, those nice boots, you hear, you know, just, I was so proud to see him, you know, proud of my dad, right? Because he used to work at Bechtel Corporation. If you guys don't know what that is, it's a very big international piping corporation, international. And and I was so proud of him. Not only was he an engineer, and so when I was a junior hire, I wanted to be an engineer, you know? I wanted to be like my dad. I had no idea what an engineer was. I wanted to be an engineer. I had no idea, you know, I wanted to be an engineer. My dad, though, also was very popular socially. You know, very good looking. You can tell, right? Very talented. You know, he's athletic. For his age, I was very surprised. You know, when we had like softball tournaments, you know, he used to always like, I was like amazed at my dad's prowess because he had a big old belly, you know, when he came home. I was like, man, my dad can move for a big belly guy, right? He could sing well. He could play the guitar. So every time we had a family get together, he would break out with his guitar and be like, rolling, rolling down the river. Dun, 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 dun. You guys know that song? What's that name of the song? Anyway, yeah. So he was very popular socially. He was making a lot of money. He had it all. He wasn't diamond in the rough. He was a diamond, right? Until some of his friends said, hey, let's make some money. Hey, we're in America. You're making, you know, pretty money, but let's make some real money. We can live comfortable lives. Let's start a business. American dream, you know? No, American dream. money. So, he quit his job, started his own business, started drinking, you know, got into more drinking, and then he fell away into oblivion, you know? And, and I've been praying for him, you know, for a long, long time. And you know how it is when you see someone with so much potential to be somebody just ruining his life, you know? That's how Jesus feels about the church in Laodicea. That's how Jesus feels about the church, because it's not living up to its potential. It's not fulfilling her purpose. Let's go to the next slide. He says, I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. You're not hot or cold. Now, some people may think the hot and the cold here is talking about if I'm hot for God. And if I'm cold, I'm cold for God. So he's, you know, you may think like, okay, this is talking about be really bad or be really good. Either or the other. It's not that. Okay? So don't think it's like, oh, Jesus said I could be cold and be all rebel. He's not talking about that. He's talking about having purpose. Do you have purpose for your life? Are you making a difference existing. All the things that you're striving for, the things that you're committed to, all the things that you're buying in this world, is there a purpose to that? That's what he's talking about, okay? For example, you ever go to Starbucks and they'll ask you, you order a tall Americano, please. You know, they'll ask you, you want that hot or cold? And I say, lukewarm, please. Try that. No, I want it lukewarm. They don't have lukewarm as an option, do they? Do you, Christine? Do you ever ask, would you like it lukewarm? Why? There's no purpose for a lukewarm drink. If it's cold, it refreshes you. If it's hot, it warms you. Try drinking warm, lukewarm caramel macchiato or a lukewarm frappuccino, you know, when it's all melted down, right? It's all with the whipped cream and the caramel and the, you just want to vomit. That's what Christ is saying. There's no purpose. If you're not cold, if you're not hot, you're not being effective. You're not committed to anything. There's no purpose for you. Why? Okay? And by the way, Laodicea, it was close to two cities, the two cities were known for their hot and cold waters. Hierapolis, which was up north, was known for their hot springs. And what they used the hot springs was for medicinal baths. Okay? So the hot water, right, at the springs in the bath. And sometimes I wonder, is that really a hot spring? Because all they have to do is just heat it up. How would we ever know? They call it hot spring, you know? Anyways, so I just wonder, hot spring. Medicinal purpose. Colossae was to the west. And they had a lot of cold spring water. They used that for drinking. See? And when Christ is telling the people of Laodicea, that's what he's saying. Hey, look. Colossae, you're not like the cold water there that refreshes. You're not like the hot bath in Hierapolis that's used for medicinal purposes. You have no purpose right now. You're not committed to anything. Okay? Why? Why is that? And you know, Jesus did say that we are supposed to be the salt of the earth, didn't we? We're supposed to be the light of the world. Right? Salt as a preservative, a light that shows, you know, which is the right way to go. And so these two, the church wasn't fulfilling, right? So Jesus sees the potential of his church disappearing and not fulfilling her purpose in the world. And what he's doing in this letter is calling them back to himself, to a commitment to himself. And he's showing all the reasons why the church should come back. This works. Next. Jesus says, this is the main message that Christ has. He says, be earnest and repent. Now, the word earnest here, some translations have be zealous. Okay, you know what zealous means, right? Be enthusiastic, be passionate. But that translation, zealous, earnest, doesn't do justice to exactly what this word means. In Greek, it means zeluo, and it means to envy. Okay? To envy, to really want something, right? To be jealous, right? How many of you guys have ever been jealous? Okay? Like, why is she talking to me? No. Hey, what? No, who are you texting? When you get jealous, you get overprotective, right? Like, why are you late? Asking you all these questions. But when you're jealous because you're striving for something, right? And you want something. And so that's the word here. And it's in a good sense, it means to imitate and to strive after, you see? to imitate and to strive after. So when he says be earnest, what Christ is saying is to come back to me, to commit to me, you know? So Christ is calling a commitment back to himself, okay? And he's giving you the reasons, okay? Why should the church commit to Christ is the question. Why should I make a commitment to Christ? And you have to think, am I committed to Christ? I'm a Christian, but am I committed to Christ? And the reason why we need to, number one, I talked about it before, which is we lose our purpose and effectiveness as Christians when we don't have a commitment to Christ, when we're not committed, okay? When you're all in, okay? When you're passionate and when you're earnest for Christ and the things of God, you don't have that, you will not live up to the purpose for what God created you for. You will not live up to the potential that God has for you, okay? That's the number one reason. You'll have no purpose for God on the earth. Second is because we have spiritual needs only Christ can satisfy. Okay? There are two kinds of needs. We have physical, right? We need to eat. We need to sleep. There are a lot of other physical needs we have. Just like that, we also have spiritual needs. Okay? Spiritual needs only Christ can meet. And so, here the Laodiceans, the problem with this church, they were only focusing on meeting their physical needs. Okay? Trying to be comfortable, right? Trying to make a life here comfortable on this, planet. They're only focused on one part of the need. And the problem with that is that when you become comfortable, when you accomplish that goal, you think you're all right, okay? And you forget about your spiritual needs. And so, next, Jesus says, you say I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and I do not need a thing, but you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. Okay? The adjective wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked, those are all figure of speech describing one reality of your spiritual need. Your heart needs, okay? Your heart needs. That's what he's talking about. Billy Graham, he said that art and education may refine the taste, but they cannot purify the heart and regenerate the individual. Art, education, you could add money, you could add comfort, you could add prestige. It may refine you. It's not going to change your heart. Why do you need to change your heart? I'm going to talk about that a little bit later. So, in the world, we view wealth as acquiring material possessions for ourselves, nice house, good car, money in the bank, nice clothes, vacations, whatever. But there's a different kind of wealth, okay, in God. Okay? It's a very precious gift that only Christ can give. Eternal treasure that no one can take away, that can come only from a certain heart. Okay? So we were created to bear fruit for the kingdom of God. And our purpose is to be salt and light and to seek the treasure of heaven and not the treasure of this world. Riches may provide comfort. You may like that. Riches may give you entertainment temporarily, but they will not give you true lasting satisfaction. They will not give you true hope. They will not give you peace. they will not give you true security, because the human heart, what it really yearns for is glory. The human heart yearns for glory. Okay? And so we need to commit to Christ, because we do have a spiritual DNA. Okay? Just as you have a physical DNA, you have a spiritual DNA that must be restored, and only Christ can do. So what does a restored spiritual DNA look like? Let's go to verse 18. He says, I counsel you to buy from me gold. Okay? Christ has something. Something worthy of buying. Something of worth. Okay? And that's why he uses the word buy here. Okay? It's worth buying. You know how, like, you know, you guys buy stuff. You know what you guys buy? Houses, shoes. Yeah. It's worth. Christ has something that is worthy and valuable for you to buy. What are they? Gold refined in the fire so you can become rich. White clothes to wear so you can cover your shame and nakedness. And salve to put on your eyes so you can see. To buy means to make a commitment. To buy from Christ is to make a commitment to Christ. And the gold here represents treasure, because it says, so that you may be rich, okay? And the rich here is not talking about naturally money or earthly treasures. It's talking about heavenly riches. And I just said riches that people can't touch, okay? Something more valuable than that. True riches, true treasure. Let me give you an example of what that rich or that wealth is. What Christ is talking about is a different purpose for living. Okay? A different purpose. God's purpose. So, there's a documentary film that came out called The Dropbox. Anyone hear of Dropbox? Okay. So it's a documentary about a pastor in Korea who created a Dropbox attached to his house because so many children were being abandoned in the city because they were born, you know, with deformity or handicapped or whatever. The parents didn't have the guts to abort, and they just abandoned him in the city. So instead of, you know, having all these kids just die in the streets, he created a Dropbox. So if someone did want to throw away their child, instead of putting them on the street, they would just put the child in the Dropbox, and the pastor could just come, you know, and get the child. And he raises these orphans. You know, he's raised hundreds of orphans, and he lives with about 20 each time. But Brian Ivey, he's a filmmaker in the U.S., one day he was reading the newspaper and saw this article, you know, Korean man makes Dropbox and takes care of orphans, and he was kind of moved by this. So he decided to make a film about it, and he went to Korea, and he lived with the pastor for weeks. He slept with the kids, okay? And he made a documentary of it. And when he was interviewed and asked, Brian, you know, you lived day to day and you saw everything that happened. What was the one thing that really impacted you? And the surprising thing was, he didn't say Pastor Lee. He didn't talk about the volunteer missionaries. He named this one grandmother. And he said, he saw this one grandmother wake up early in the morning every day, and he would, and she would, you know, chop and start making food for 20 plus people in the house every single day, early in the morning, getting up, and she wasn't even included in the documentary, just making food for these kids. And Brian says this, what I realized was, if this grandma wasn't serving the kids like this, there would be no orphanage here. Those orphans would not survive, you know, with this grandma serving the kids. And so when we meet Christ in heaven, and as all the pastors and missionaries, all the Christians, they're meeting Christ, right? I wouldn't be surprised if Jesus comes to this grandmother, right? Gives her a hug, You did well. Here's the crown. Here's the crown. You served well, right? Look at all these kids in heaven. They're here because of your service. And she'll look at all these hundreds of kids, that she saw and fed. No recognition, but serving. Right? And that's the treasure in heaven. Okay? That's the rich in heaven. Living for others, right? And giving to others. So when Christ, when he says, come and buy from me gold refined in the fire, talking about living for a different purpose, okay? Not for yourself. Not accumulating things for yourself, but doing things for others. That's the treasure, okay? When you give, Jesus said, it's blessed to give than to receive, right? And many times Jesus said, sell your possessions because God, your Father, has given you the kingdom. Give it to the poor, right? And Jesus told a parable, too, about how a man who did really well in his business and his vats were overflowing. He said, man, I have so much food. I have, so much property. What should I do? I know. I'll make another storage bin, and I'll store all my stuff there, right? And what did Jesus say? You fool. Your soul is required very night, tonight. God's going to call you to your maker, right? And then what are you going to do with all your riches? Who's going to take all your riches, right? So the gold represents here a new purpose, okay? So the second thing that a restored spiritual DNA looks like has to do with the white clothing. The white clothing. The white clothing represents, in the Bible, righteousness. Righteousness. Next verse. No, actually, stay there. Yeah, stay there. So you can cover your shameful nakedness. White clothes to wear so you can cover your shameful nakedness, right? And, we all have sins. We all have weaknesses, don't we? Okay? And we're all unique in that way. Something that we're not proud of. Something that if someone else would see, right, we would be shameful, right? But what that means is that all of us, we need grace, okay? And Jesus is the one who is able to cover us with his grace, okay? And here, what Jesus is promising is that I'm going to cover you with my grace. I'm going to forgive you. I'm going to wash you, okay? And some of us may have, one of my weaknesses is that I'm a people pleaser. Okay? So in Korean, it's like, 눈치가, right? Am I doing the right thing? I'm like, making sure, right, what I'm doing is acceptable. That's my weakness. And I come before Christ, I'm like, God, don't let me be affected by what people think. Let me just look to what pleases you. Help me to focus on you. Let me not look to what, the approval of others. We all have different weaknesses. And Christ is saying, your security, right? I'm going to give you that white a cloth to cover your shame, to cover your weaknesses, okay? Lastly, eyeball. He says, salve. I'll give you salve to put on your eyes so that you can buy, right? So you can see, you know? And the Laodiceans, this church, they were so rich. You know, it was one of the wealthiest cities, you know, like Calgary. And everyone was wealthy. The Christians were wealthy. The thing is, this wealth blinded them from seeing the kingdom of God. They blinded them from seeing what's more important in life, right? And they forgot about living for God, living for Christ, the purpose for why they were living, okay? And sometimes it takes drastic events to help us see the reality, okay? And I want to share an example of something that happened to like this a person, and it's like a testimony and a prayer okay? What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna try to read it and translate it in Korean, okay? So. Alright, I'm just gonna translate. Okay, it's in Korean, but I'm just gonna translate it, so just bear with me, okay? 4 years ago, through a friend, I came to this sanctuary, okay? And I was baptized here, and I even started taking the new believers class, and it was a wonderful thing. But something happened that I couldn't finish this class. And because okay, this is what I'm gonna do. I'm just gonna read it in Korean, okay? And then I'm just gonna explain it, summarize it in English. Yeah, I think that's better. So bear with me. So, 4년 전 후배 인도로 이곳 성 김대건 성당에 오게 된 저는 지난 성탄에 세례를 받고 이어서 올해 4월에 견진의 은총까지 받는 행아가 되었습니다. 예비자 교리반에서 믿음의 본질과 신앙 안의 자세에 대해 주옥 같은 말씀들을 접할 수 있었건만 교리반에 출석을 하지 못할 사정들이 생기게 되었지요. 계약된 회사에서 약 5개월간 급료를 전혀 받지 못하게 되자 도미노 현상처럼 집도 잃고 차도 잃고 재물도 다 잃은 채 인생의 막다른 골목에 와 있었습니다. 내일이면 집을 비워주고 길거리에 나 앉게 된 절망의 상황에서 후배로부터 연락이 왔습니다. 교리반에 나오지 않고 있던 저를 신부님께서 한번 보자고 하신다는 것이었습니다. 어떻게 교리반에 자주 결석하던 못난 한 마리 양을 기억하셨을까요? 그 만남을 통해 신부님께서는 저에게 묵을 수 있는 거처를 마련해 주셨지요. 정말 일순간에 보잘것없는 저에게 기적과도 같은 은총이 쏟아졌습니다. 덕분에 스스로의 생명을 포기했을지도 모를 절망 속에서 다시금 용기를 되찾아 새롭게 삶을 유지할 수 있었습니다. 오늘까지 이렇게 무난히 살아갈 수 있도록 자비를 베풀어 주신 주님께 감사 기도를 드립니다. 울타리 안에 있는 99마리의 양떼들보다 길을 얻은 한 마리 양을 돌봐주신 하느님의 지고하신 사랑에 감동하지 않을 수 없었습니다. 특별한 은총을 받은 저희에게 그 놀라운 은총에 대해 많이 생각해보고 기도해보고 묵상해보았습니다. 그 가운데 저는 새로운 것들을 볼 수 있었습니다. 성령님의 자비하신 손길, 감미롭고 거룩한 성전, 영적 반려자인 형제 자매들과의 아름다운 관계, 전에는 보이지 않았던 것들을 볼 수 있었지요. 그러나 저 라페엘 이대로 좋을까요?
제 나이가 이제 60하고도 아홉. 지난 날의 삶을 뒤돌아보면 유독 팔란만장했지요. 일일 연속급 작가도 아닌 제가 하루하루 극적인 일들의 연속이었고, 자칭 세상의 모든 장비와 시설에 관한 핸디맨, 엔지니어, 과학자이자 해결사라고 떠벌리고 다니는 교만, 방자하고 어리석은 사람이었습니다. 그러니 이제 남은 생은 많은 교우들로부터 받은 넘치는 위로와 사랑에 보답하여 주님만을 똑바로 바라보고 걸어가야 하겠지요. 그러나 남은 생을 주님의 도구로 쓸 수만 있다면 영광의 길이라 생각하지만, 아직도 우매한 제 눈은 새 속에 열매어 앞을 똑바로 바라볼 수가 없습니다. 눈을 떴지만 아직도 어둠 속을 방황하고 있으니 저는 눈뜬 소경이며 영적인 소경입니다. 예수님께서 엘리코의 눈먼 거지 바르테메오의 눈을 뜨게 해주신 기적과 같이 저의 어리석음과 교만으로 보이지 않게 된 제 영혼의 눈을 뜨게 해주시기를 청합니다. 스승님, 제가 다시 볼 수 있게 해주십시오. So basically in English, this man, he was about to lose everything because of his job. But his pastor called him and gave him a place to stay. And as he began to think about of that graciousness, he began to see the things that he didn't see before, like the love of his brothers and sisters in Christ in the church, the wonderfulness of the church, and also the spiritual things that he didn't see before. And so this person wants now to live and pay back for the grace that he has received. But the problem is he's lost in darkness in the world, and he cannot see the things that he wants to see. He cannot see the beauty of God, and he's still lost in the world. And what he's praying is that his eyes would be opened like the blind eyes that Jesus opened, right? And his prayer is, Lord, open my blind eyes to see you. A lot of times, we live, our lives, and we miss the things of God. We miss, we don't see, the things that we should be living for. And this is a prayer written by a person who had to go through hard times. To slightly open his eyes, okay, to turn back to the Lord. Okay? This was written by my dad. And I think it's a prayer for all of us, that we would see that Christ would open our eyes. The reason why we need to turn to Christ are these three things. To find a purpose a purpose for God, okay? To find true peace in our hearts, and for eyes to be opened, okay? Where do you go, right? Where do you go to buy what you want, to buy what you need? Where do you go to get your life? Okay? To become satisfied, where do you go? Where do you look to? Jesus says, come to me. Buy from me. I'm going to give you lasting riches. I'm going to give you peace. I'm going to cover you. I'm going to make you see things that you haven't seen before. Spiritual things. Okay? And Christ knocks on the door of our hearts, and he invites us to commit to him. Okay? When he says, buy from me, he's saying, make the commitment. Commit to me. Give your heart to me. But it's an invitation, right? Because he's at the door and he's knocking. That's an invitation. He doesn't barge barge in. He doesn't force us to change. It's up to us to open the door. It's up to us to open our hearts. It's up to us to respond to that invitation. Okay? To renew our commitment to Him so that we would have a purpose that's greater than the things of this world. Okay? That we would find the peace that we can't find in this world. That we would find the grace that covers us when we're weak. We will find the grace to forgive us of our sins. To forgive us of our sins and to make us right before God. And that we would have the salve that Christ gives so that we can see the things that are really important in life and not be blind to maybe our own spiritual condition. And Christ says, I counsel you to buy from me gold you don't have. Christ says, buy, but we don't really have to pay, okay? When Christ says, buy from me the gold, He's saying, make a commitment to me, okay? Make a commitment. We don't have to buy anything because Christ has paid for these things. If you look at these three things, these are the gold. It's not just gold that you just find, you know, in the bed, right? It's gold that's been refined by fire. Okay? Someone has refined the fire, okay? So that we can be rich. There's a refining in the gold, okay? And on the cross, Jesus became poor, and He went through the fire of suffering, you see? So that we might become rich. It's not free gold. Someone has paid the price, but Christ says, buy it from me because it's a precious thing. Come and get it from me, okay? This is a gold that's been refined in the fire. And what about the white cloak, the white clothes? Are clothes always white? No, there's stain on the clothes. There's dirt on the clothes. But this cloak is white because it's been washed. Christ took up our sins on the cross. He washed it clean, right, with His blood. And that's why the cloak is white, and He's able to cover us and forgive us. And the salve. Jesus cured our spiritual blindness by dying on the cross and rising from the dead so that we might see the hope of the resurrection, that we might see there's a kingdom of God, and that we might have eternal life. And all these things, Christ paid on the cross with His life, with His blood. So, and Christ invites us, He knocks on the door of our hearts and says, come buy from me. Make a commitment to me and I'll give you these things. I'll give you a new purpose. I'm going to give you peace. I'm going to forgive you of your sins, right? And I'm going to open your eyes to see the things that you really need to see. Okay? And so I want to ask you this question. Are you in darkness? Are you in need of a purpose for your life? Do you want to live up to the full potential for what God created you to be? Okay? Do you need forgiveness for your sins? The sins that you still have and that's not taken care of? Okay? Do you need Christ's grace to cover you, to cover your shame, to cover your nakedness, that when you go before God, you would have this cloak, this white cloak before God, that you will not be ashamed when people see you, when God sees you, okay? And do you want to see something new, something more? The kingdom of God, okay? Something more than that this world can offer, right? Eternal life. Christ is calling the church to be earnest, to commit, to become passionate, about the things of God, to be passionate about Christ, to make a commitment to Christ. See? And you see the little money thingy, my treasure. Okay, you guys have that? I'm going to make an invitation for you guys. If you want to make a commitment to Christ, Jesus says, come buy for me this gold. I'm going to give you a new purpose. Okay? Buy for me this white cloak. I'm going to wash your sins clean. You're going to be completely clean. I'm going to give you salve to put on your eyes so that you can see what you're supposed to live for. So that you can see the eternal things of God. Okay? So this ticket that I give you is an invitation. Okay? And so if you want to come to Christ, make a commitment to Him, and you want to come to Christ. You want to buy the gold that's been refined by the fire. you want to buy, you want to get this cloak that Christ will give me to cover my shame. And I want the salve to put on my eyes so that I can see clearly, so I can see the things of God. Okay? I want you to take it, come up, and lay it. Go to the next slide. Next one. Alright, so there's the cross. I want you to lay it before the cross. And basically what you're doing is, Christ says, I stand at the door and knock. Anyone opens my door, I'm going to come into him, I'm going to eat with him, and he's going to eat with me. I'm gonna make a permanent friendship with this person. I'm gonna be with that person, okay? And so this, when you bring it up here, you're saying, you know, I open the door of my heart, and I'm making a commitment to you, Lord. I want that gold refined in the fire. I want that white cloak that's gonna cover my shame and my sin, and I want the salve so that my eyes can see, just like my dad prayed, Lord, open my eyes so I can see the things of God, the important things of God, and I may not look to the things of this world. So, this is your time. If you're ready, we'll just wait a few minutes. Maybe no one will come up, but it's okay. I'm giving you an invitation for you to make a commitment to Christ. Okay, so just come up, put it, just lay it here and stay here, and we're just going to pray together if you want to make a commitment to Christ.